I want to say hello and greet all of you. I'm Dr. Elizabeth Edgerly, the Chief Program Officer for the Alzheimer's Association. And this is my 17th year with the Updates on Dementia Conference. So, and it is my pleasure to introduce our next two speakers to you this afternoon. I'll start with introducing Patrick Arbore, who will actually be the second presenter. But let me start with Dr. Arbore. Patrick began his career in the field of aging in 1973. He is the founder and director of the Center for Elderly Suicide Prevention and Grief-Related Services. This is a program of the Institute on Aging in San Francisco. Patrick conducts workshops and presents lectures locally and nationally on aging-related subjects, including elderly suicide prevention, ageism, hoarding, substance abuse, compassion fatigue, communication, depression, traumatic loss, and many other subjects. If you're from the Bay Area, no doubt your paths have crossed at some point or another, because Patrick really is one of the shining stars in our community as an expert on all of these topics and others. He's also an author of, he's authored numerous articles and book chapters on various aging-related topics. He's a senior lecturer in the Human Services Division at Notre Dame de Namur University in Belmont. And Patrick was the recipient of the 2013 Mental Health and Aging Award presented by ASA, the American Society on Aging, for his outstanding contributions in the field of aging. In January 2015, Patrick was selected as a silver medalist for public service, sponsored by the Jefferson Award Regional Committee. So we'll be hearing from Patrick second, but first I get to invite up my colleague, Judy Filippoff. Judy is the Director of Early Stage Services, and I've done some really wonderful things in my tenure with the Alzheimer's Association. It'll be 20 years. In September, and 19 years ago, I hired Judy Filippoff, which was one of the best things I had ever done, and continues to be one of the best things I've done. And the reason for that, as Judy says, I know she cringes when I say this, is she is truly one of the leading experts in early stage services nationwide. She was one of the first people doing work in this area all those years ago, when it was hard to even find people in the early stages because they were diagnosed so much later, if ever. And so I feel really fortunate that we get to have her here and that she's going to share some of her experience with you today. So back to her bio. Judy Filippoff works out of the Alzheimer's Association East Bay site office and is the director of our early stage services for Northern California and Northern Nevada. She began a national group of early stage program providers, was a member of the National Alzheimer's Association Early Stage Professional Task Force, and provides consultation and training to professionals on serving individuals with Alzheimer's disease or related disorders in the early stages. She's a frequent presenter at community, family, and professional conferences on early stage issues, and she has over 30 years of experience working with people with Alzheimer's, their families, and healthcare professionals throughout the Bay Area. So we're going to start with Judy sharing some case discussion, so please join me in welcoming Judy Filippoff.
Thanks, Elizabeth. So I'm going to put this up a little. There we go. We were thinking that before Patrick shares really in depth about this really, really important subject, that by way of grounding everybody to the subject itself, it might be helpful if we talked about a particular person who had early stage Alzheimer's disease and was struggling with the option of suicide for himself. And so I'll be talking today about one of our early stage support group members. But before I do that, I just want to give you a little bit of an overview of the early stage group so there's some context for you. So our early stage support groups serve individuals who have a physician's diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease or something like that, are aware of that diagnosis and mildly affected by their symptoms, and they want to talk to other people who also have a diagnosis. So it's a very unique kind of offering. When we find people, we do pre-screen everybody before they come into a group to make sure they fit that criteria, but also because if we find people who are who either present with suicidal ideation, or perhaps they just seem to be have major depression, there might be other issues that make them not a good member of a peer support group structure, then we refer them out for more robust clinical services, for example, to Patrick. We sometimes refer them to their physician for medications or evaluations. There's other therapy types that they might benefit from. And sometimes we refer people to protective services right at the outset because we think they're a danger to self or others. So because we do all of this pre-screening of people, we don't have a lot of people that bring up the topic of suicide within our groups. It does happen. When it does happen, to be honest, we are grateful as facilitators. And the reason for that is because we realize the group is a safe place for them if they're bringing up this topic that is often taboo. And on the other hand, we can also help to normalize that feeling for them so we can both respond to it and help to normalize it. Usually when it comes up in a group, however, it's because of an outside influence. So something like the movie Still Alice, I don't know if people have seen that, but some people have seen that movie and they come in and they talk more in general terms about the topic of dying by suicide and that sort of thing. So there's a lot of diversity in this topic, and I'm just going to present our experience with one person who I've got to tell you was one of the best people I've ever met. His name is Jake. Jake was 65 when he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. He was probably the most independent person I've ever met. Jake built his own house in his late 50s, early 60s, and I mean he hammered the nails. And I had occasion to visit his house a couple of times, and it was built on the side of a hill, and there was a stream running down, you know, beneath the house. And I thought the amount of work he had to do just in terms of soil gradation and that sort of thing would have been so extensive, and that wasn't his field. That wasn't what he did. He was just a leader in his church community. He had been a Boy Scout leader. He was just this great guy who was so earnest and so giving and so honest. And in addition to having Alzheimer's disease, at the same time Jake was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease, his wife was diagnosed with a terminal illness and was told she had about a year to live. And to make it all worse, Jake, in addition to that, had macular degeneration and was slowly going blind. And so he had so many losses going on. And yet, even in the pre-screening with Jake, I was so impressed with how well put together he was and how he knew exactly what his purpose was in life, which was to take care of his wife until she passed. So one day during the support group, after he had been in the group, I think for about 3 months, the group was talking about how their independence was changing and their sense of self was changing with that, and how they strive to remain independent in spite of the fact that they needed help with some things. And Jake said, "I'm here until my wife dies, and then I plan to kill myself." And it was a complete shock to me. And it was a complete shock to the rest of the group. They all looked like sort of deer caught in headlights kind of thing. They all stared right at me, you know, "What are you going to do about this?" And I thought, "What am I going to do about this?" And so I asked Jake, "When did you make that decision?" And he said, "Pretty much when my wife was diagnosed." He said, my purpose in life is to care for her. And then after that, I don't have any desire to be dependent on anybody. You know, I know what life looks like at the end of this, and, you know, this is awful. And so there was no normalizing it within the group because of the rest of the group. When I asked them if they'd ever had a similar thought, they all said no. So I asked Jake if we could talk after the group, letting the group know, of course, at that point that this was on me, that I was going to talk to Jake. And he said that was fine. So we went on with the group, and we just went back to the discussion of independence and that sort of thing. And then so we met after the group, and I asked Jake if he had told his wife what his plan was, and he hadn't. And so I asked if we could call her together, and so he could talk to his wife. And he said, sure. So we put her on speaker, and we gave his wife a call. And she wasn't as worried about it as I was, to be honest. She said, "I would imagine that everybody has that thought sometimes, and you know, I'm not really worried that he'll do that." And so I said, "Well, you know, I take it very seriously. Is it possible for me to get your pastor's phone number?" Because he had talked a lot about his relationship with the pastor, and they both said okay. So I took the pastor's number and hung up the phone, and I talked to Jake a little bit more because I just wanted to get a bit more information from him. And as it turns out, he had a method, and it was something hidden, and he wouldn't tell me where it was. So then I was really concerned. So I told him at that point I needed to report it to Adult Protective Services, which he was not happy with me about. He was very clear that he wasn't planning to do anything, as he put it, until his wife had passed. But I would have reported it anyway. But the reality is I have a person that has a disease that I know can affect his ability to reason. And I also don't know if his wife is going to pass from something else quickly and he's going to make that decision. He has a method, and I took it very seriously. And so he understood that, but they weren't going to change his mind, as he put it. So he understood that. So I did end up visiting the home. Adult Protective Services, by the way, did go out to the house. They made a visit, and they referred back to the Alzheimer's Association, and I was grateful for that. Even if I was the referral source, I was glad they were thinking of us. That's always good. But you know, I don't think it really made a big difference for Jake, having them come out. And so I went out, I brought a colleague with me for support, and went out, and we met with Jake and his wife and the pastor. And Jake was pretty noncommittal. He wouldn't say, he was really honest, so I knew he wasn't going to say that he wasn't going to die by suicide if he had that intent. And he wouldn't say, I will or I won't. So we found out during this meeting that when he was in his early 20s, his best friend had died by suicide. And so that, of course, increased his risk even more, so we were pretty concerned about that. And the pastor did a really good job of explaining to Jake the religious consequences around their faith and whether if he chose to die by suicide. And Jake, you know, listened very respectfully, but didn't necessarily agree with that. He was sort of just not going there so much. We were helpful, myself and my colleague. We talked to Jake about the reality that his best friend dying by suicide, in fact, might have increased his risk. And if he decides to go that route, it might increase his son's risk, his grandchildren's risk, and all of that. And that's a reality. We weren't trying to scare him, but he is really responsible. And so he took that to heart and thought about that a little bit more. So we ended up making another visit out, same exact scenario, just sort of talking to everybody. But Jake was open. He was talking. And it was good that he was talking about it, I think. So we went back to group. And Jake continued to bring up that he was considering committing suicide, is how he'd put it. I'm going to commit suicide. I'm going to kill myself. I'm thinking about that. And so what would happen in the group is that because the rest of the group members were not so inclined to have that discussion, they were pretty panicked by it. And so what ended up happening was as though Jake was over here having a conversation with me about his consideration of whether or not he's going to die by suicide, and the rest of the group over here having their discussion with me on a completely different topic, and they weren't meeting at all. And so Jake was actually, in my opinion, isolated within his own group of peers and was really lost. And so I called Patrick and said, what do I do? I said, I've got this guy. I need him to stay in the group. I need him to have a place. And Patrick gave the best advice ever, and I've used it 500 times since, which is, acknowledge that it's a heavy subject and you're going to talk about it for 10 minutes. And then if Jake wants to continue to talk about it, you're going to talk to him after the group. And the very first day I did that, it worked like a charm. So Jake brought this up. I said 10 minutes. And the group eventually started getting more and more engaged around the topic of loss of independence, fear of the future, all those things that Jake could relate to. And they could relate to. So it was like a meeting in the middle for them, I think. And then Jake and I would talk after the group. And just over time, he brought that up as an option less and less. And so I was checking in with him in the group for a while. And he'd say, it wasn't so emotionally charged. It was just like, well, I'm thinking about it. And then I'd talk to him after the group sometimes. It was the same thing. And then he started bringing in his son, who'd been kind of estranged from, started to be more a part of his life because his wife was getting sicker. And so the son was helping get the wife enrolled in hospice and all these things. So they were talking a bit more. And he came into group one day and said that he and his son had visited some assisted living facilities. So he'd have a place to live after his wife passed away. And I just thought that, you know, best news ever. I was so excited for him. And so what ended up happening is Jake's wife did pass away. He was a huge part of her care at the very end. He, when he built the house, she loved trees, so he angled her hospital bed so that she was looking outside where all the trees were at the stream. Even if she wasn't conscious, he wanted her to have an opportunity to see that kind of thing. One thing I did forget to say, by the way, is that about 2 months after Jake had disclosed this, his wife called me and she had found a loaded gun in his tool shed, which was, you know, several feet away from the house, sort of across a stream. And I have no idea whether he forgot that he had left it there, she had gotten rid of it, or he was just no longer able to negotiate his way down there because his eyes were getting so bad. So things had changed for him quite a bit at that point. So after his wife passed away, Jake did move into an assisted living facility. And, you know, he was a really strapping, independent, single male. And there were lots of Twitter-pated single females. So he was really happy at that time. I mean, as, you know, and I don't mean to make light of what he was feeling, but his life was so different than the life he had envisioned, right? So, and he was there. He lived in this one place. He had a girlfriend for a while who was very sweet. And he lived there for about 4 or 5 months and then actually moved to another country where his son lived so he could be closer to the son. So, you know, I have no idea whether Jake consciously made a decision not to die by suicide, whether his capacity changed and he was no longer able to make that decision, which was frankly his fear, or what. But I know that the life that he described for me that he thought he was going to have was completely different than the life he ended up with after his wife passed. So I hope that helps a little to kind of understand just one person's story. I'll be around if you have any questions, but right now I'm going to turn it over to Patrick.
Thank you, Judy. I thought Judy did a really good job with that. We had done a conference call looking at that particular vignette with Jake, and had a number of people that facilitate some of these groups, and I thought it was just a really helpful exercise for everyone. I'm very glad to be here today. It's really an honor to be with all of you today, and it's good to see colleagues and former colleagues and people that I've met from schools and universities. If in the hallway you wave at me or something and I don't even recognize you, it's because I'm having a little trouble with my vision, and I was saying earlier. And so it's not that I'm ignoring you. You just have to make your presence really known. And I will respond. So many things that Judy said are crucial, and especially, and I know you highlighted that, that so many people in those situations, particularly when the person in the caregiving role, the family caregiver role, is also someone that is dealing with significant symptoms of dementia or other types of illnesses, that's just so hard. I mean, I heard that vignette before, but it really touches me, and I'm glad you used that, because I think that's something that so many of us may not have bumped into, maybe as professional helpers and therapists or whatever, but we might not have been in that particular role, and I thought you expressed that really well. And what I was thinking was, what Judy did so expertly was attention. You know, let's give Jake some attention. And I feel that that is so crucial when somebody tells you, and what we see in the literature too is very much what Judy was saying, is that many times people will express their intention. So he just said, this is what I'm doing. And that's not always the case with a lot of people, but still there is an effort to get us to understand how serious this is, that their assumption about how the world was going to be down the road has changed dramatically. And yet, as we saw with him, that he was able to move into this assisted living, and things changed. So the assumptive world, although might not be the way he had planned with his wife, something else happened. But how do we hold on to that person long enough so that they can witness and experience that is part of the challenge. We see this often on our 24-hour line, and as Judy said, Friendship Line can be a very appropriate resource for clients or patients of yours, family members, who really need some added support. And not only can they call in, you know, we're a 24-hour accredited hotline crisis intervention as well as a warm line, but we'll also call out to people. And that's one of the ways in which we connect with older individuals who might be having some kind of cognitive memory loss, may have had a diagnosis of symptoms of dementia. And we call out to many, many people. And I think that that can be a support. Because one of the things we really believe in is that connections are what bind us to life. And so I just think it's crucial that if you feel that you have someone who is still trying to remain as independent as possible, particularly men, and I just draw our attention to that value system. If people have a fierce connection with independence, that even the thought of losing that, and I'm sure there are people in this room, you know, who have said to others, other colleagues, hey, if that happens to me, if I lose my memory, if it even comes close to that, I'm going to, you know, do something. And what they might not say is that I'm considering ending my life prematurely. And I think that's the other thing that we in this room have to think about, that if I'm thinking about that, and yet I am the helper or I'm the professional caregiver or psychologist or whatever, I really need to look at my countertransference. And I think that is so important for us to be aware of and why I think this topic is good for us to look at. Just in terms of the Friendship Line, which began in 1973, as you heard, and I know that's surprising that I'm only 43, and I know I was a child prodigy back in 1973. That's why I look so young. But the idea then was that we really knew that people need to feel connected. And if they feel connected, and as Jake obviously did with you, that is so valuable. And it's so inexpensive, you know? It's not like a tricky, confusing intervention. It's just, I hear you, you know, and I take you seriously. And that's very important. In the last month, in the month of April, we had between 9,000 and 10,000 incoming and outgoing calls in the month of April on the Friendship Line. So we have a lot of experience working with people like Judy was describing. So we want to be aware, and you have this in your handouts, these slides. What we see is that older people are still have a very high rate of suicide. Dr. Conwell and others are aware of that, but also we see this spike in men particularly who are in middle age. And we certainly had a lot of attention and focus on Robin Williams at the age of 63, who in August took his life. And so there has been, you know, a little bit more interest in looking at this. And then again, it's very important that we know that older adults are the fastest growing age category, and the 85 plus is certainly the fastest growing age category in America today. But what we're concerned about are the aging boomers, those born between 1946 and 1964. And I am in that crowd as well. And what I'm seeing, certainly through the Friendship Line, but also in my work in other areas, is that I bump into a lot of people in that cohort who are really saying, as I mentioned earlier, that if I lose my mind, is what they often say, that's it, you know? And we really need, in terms of prevention, is to, you know, be able to talk about this a little earlier. Rather than waiting, as with Jake, that he waited and then had an opening and he blurted that out. But I think it's important that we talk about it with people who don't have early stage dementia, and allow that to be a conversation that we can have with people, which is, yeah, how would you deal with this should this happen? You know, and again, what we know in terms of the literature is that talking about suicide doesn't plant the idea. A lot of researchers in the field of aging would say that suicide is in the back of the mind of older people anyway. Well, that doesn't surprise me, since we're an ageist society. And what is the worst thing to be in America today is to be old. And then if you're old and you're having memory loss or starting to worry about that, I was just with a woman the other day, she's 72, and she said, Patrick, what terrifies me right now was not the losses of my adult children. She had two adult children, a boy and a girl, who both died tragically. But she said, now I think I'm losing my mind, and I'm not going to go through this. I've had too much pain. And so, as Judy did, I said, we need to talk about that. And I could see just the fact that she knows that I'm open to having that discussion. I could see the relief on her face, that it's okay to talk about it. What people fear is that if they talk about it, people are going to get really excited. What you did, I thought, was very appropriate, which is, hey, these are the things we have to do, since he also said, I have the means to do it. So we want to be aware of that. This chart just indicates, again, in terms of white men particularly, have, you know, you can just see how that increases over the age span. And so who has more attempts at suicide? You know, out there in the world, people often say, well, it's young people, because anything to do with youth is like, well, that has to be the most important thing, even in something like premature death by suicide. But we know that with younger people, they might have 100 to 200 attempts to one death by suicide, but with older people, that is reduced dramatically to 4 attempts to one suicide. So when Judy took this very seriously, I really urge us to do the same thing, whether it's in a support group or whatever way in which you interact with older people. It's really important to take those comments very seriously, as Judy did. So the prediction of suicide, however, is very complex. It's not an easy process. And many of you have probably taken classes and suicide prevention trainings, and it's very difficult. But Judy also said a very important thing was, wow, this man has had so many losses. And that's the other piece of this, is how do we deal with these losses that have accumulated over a lifetime? It's very challenging, because in addition to being an ageist society, we're also a grief-denying society. And the message out there, when I hear from the grievers all the time, is don't talk about it, get over it, it's too depressing, so let's keep quiet about dad's health or mom's health or her death or whatever it might be. And we've really got to shift that paradigm so that people can have some inner resources in terms of how do we handle this kind of bad news. My wife is very ill and is going to die. I have been diagnosed with early stage dementia. What am I going to do? And we need to be able to talk about this. And we need to be aware, when we're looking at doing a quick suicide assessment, we want to be aware of some of these factors, because we've got to be able to integrate this constellation of personal demographics, psychiatric symptoms, and situational factors. You know, and not the least of those situational factors is, do I have social connections? Judy knew that there was a son, but the son had been estranged. So can that get repaired? Is there anything we can do about that? And can we introduce, you know, other social connections? it really, really matters, and that's where Friendship Line or other kinds of programs can be helpful. And these stressful life events can help explain why a suicidal crisis unfolded in a particular kind of time frame. Something happened. One of the things that I urge you to think about when you're talking to people that might be dealing with some of this stress and have harboring suicidal ideation is that I say to them, when were you aware that you started to think of death and or suicide? You know, and we know that's part of the clinical perspective on depression. When did that start, you know? And the other thing Judy acknowledged was that he had a friend who died by suicide. That just doesn't go away, you know? And to anybody in this room, and I'm sure with a group this size, there are many people in this room that have had a close connection with somebody that may have been suicidal, may have been severely depressed, and may have died by suicide. It may have been a family member or a classmate or a neighbor or a friend or a client. And I just want to empathize with you because I know that kind of death is not easy to reconcile. And as I said, Dr. Kassenbaum was one of the writers in aging who says that suicide is often in the back of the mind. So it's important to know that I can bring this up, particularly if somebody says these vague comments, which is, you might not see me at Christmas this year, or not so vague, when my wife dies, I'm not going to be around. And we need to really think about that and be able to talk about it. And this is not an uncommon feature, and this was something that, although Judy didn't use these words, but that's what I was seeing her do, which is dealing with his ambivalence. You know, and that's the mystery and the what I call that, that's kind of this very interesting place in the suicidal mind, is that they give you this intention. They say, this is just too hard, and I'm going to have a plan, and I might have a method. And what they're saying is that within me, although I'm thinking about death, there's a part of me that still has some hope, you know? And what Judy did was validated the part of him that wants to die, but also was moving him gently into continuing to live, because there's a part of him that also wants to live. But we can't just force it. We can't just push a person into, hey, everything's going to be okay. They're not going to believe you. You have to really help nurture that part that wants to live, but help them grieve that part that wants to die. And that's very important, because what the helper can represent here is support, hope, and a connection. The literature is very clear about this, that if people feel connected, but in a meaningful way, you know, as I saw many of you out in the hallway talking to each other and happy to see one another, there's a lot of just communication electricity in that. But so many people who are dealing with illnesses and other kinds of issues wind up slipping into themselves and don't get in touch with that kind of joy anymore. And they'll say things like, it's all downhill from here. And we've got to really, again, change that paradigm. And there are things we can do. And one of the sentences that you can utilize is that there's a part of you that wants to live, but there's also the part of you that wants to die. And I need to recognize that. I hear you telling me this is hard. And you're here. You know, so there's something going on that we want to cultivate, which is you're here talking to me now. And so, again, there's a variety of stressful life events, particularly prolonged illness, financial stress, you know, financial abuse. I think you talked about that earlier today, you know, and problems in relationships. And poor social support and the loss of a loved one may precipitate suicidal ideation. And we also know, again, that any kind of neurological problem, you know, and that makes me think again of Robin Williams, who, you know, was severely depressed, had been in recovery for drugs and alcohol, and also had a diagnosis of Parkinson's. And so we want to see the impact of that. We are so mind connected in our culture. We're so cognitive that we absolutely still refuse to think there's something else in this human body that doesn't have to be 100% dependent on this. One day I believe we're going to get there. And to see that there's that spirit, there's something deeper inside of us, but I don't think we're quite there yet. But I think we're heading in that direction. And so what we know in terms of caregivers is that more than two-thirds of Alzheimer's disease patients are cared for at home, usually by a spouse, usually by a female, might be a wife, it might be a daughter, a sister. And we really have to again and again and again recognize how stressful that can be. When people come to my traumatic loss grief group who've lost a loved one that had dementia, what they say is that I've totally lost my identity. That for the last 15 years or 12 years or whatever, I was, rock solid there 24/7 for my spouse or brother or son or whoever it was. Now, not only have I lost my loved one, but I lost my role, And losing one's identity at 72 or 63 is not an easy thing in our society to rebuild. Because people will say, you're old. People say that to me. I'm only 67, not 43. And but people will really say those things to me. Well, you should be retired. It's like, I don't know about you, but retirement isn't on the plan at this point. We have to be just aware of the stress on the caregivers. And the needs of these primary caregivers are many. And if these needs are overwhelming in terms of not being met, particularly the need for respite, you just can't maintain that constant state of alertness if your loved one is in, the middle stage of dementia or later, and they're wandering, and it's just so tough. And what I've heard again and again in terms of the caregivers is, once I finish with my husband or whoever, then I'm ending myself, not unlike what you were saying. And that leads me to murder suicides. I know that sounds really shocking to people, but there are those types of experiences where somebody who is usually the healthier spouse is caring for a spouse that may not be as healthy, might have symptoms of dementia, and they slip into isolation. Somewhere along the line, a discussion took place between those spouses that said something along the lines of, when you get too ill, in this case, I'm thinking about a man, the husband says, I'm going to, save you by ending your life, and then I'm going to end my own. And we have to tackle that, especially when we see, unless there's a cure for Alzheimer's somewhere soon, we're going to see more and more people dealing with this kind of situation, but that the person in the caregiver role may not have anything except love to offer. And love isn't enough when it comes to these situations of murder, suicides. And if you want more information on that, you can go to Donna Cohen, C-O-H-E-N. I don't think she's in our reference list. But Donna Cohen from South Florida is really very, very much an expert in this field. And it's something we have to really pay attention to. And so what we want to think about here is, what are some of the warning signs? And some of those Judy shared in her vignette. And so we want to be aware in terms of the problem here and how everyone is different. And that's the other thing. Not every caregiver and not every person with dementia is going to fit into some cookie cutter definition. Everybody is different, and so we need to be aware of who they are, what their personality is, but also their value system. What are their values, attitudes, and beliefs? And if their belief is no matter what, I must be independent, we got trouble when independence may be diminishing. You know, we want to know if people are feeling sad and depressed. You know, people are feeling lonely in their situation. Do I feel overwhelmed most of the time? You know, so the caregiver, we want to know, do you feel overwhelmed a lot, often, or all the time? Am I losing weight? Do I feel isolated? You know, am I drinking alcohol more than I have done in the past? Those all contribute. Are you relying more on medications? I had this one older woman who was caring for her husband who had dementia. And when I asked her about that, I said, are you drinking alcohol more than you have done in the past? And she just started laughing. And I said, what are you laughing about? And she said, I told my friends the other day when my daughter was taking care of my husband. And they said, how do you cope, Marlene or whatever, with this? And she said, I drink a lot. And she said, and we all had a good laugh. And I said, notice, Marlene, I'm not laughing. I believe you. I don't think you're kidding. And not surprisingly, she really was very depressed, and she was thinking about suicide. You know, am I screaming or crying regularly? One of my other caregivers, who was her husband, has dementia vascular type, and she said, I can't believe what's happened to me over the years that my husband has been diagnosed with vascular dementia. She said, I scream at him in a way I've never done before, and I recently slapped him across the face as hard as I could. I couldn't take it anymore. And then she said, I felt so remorseful. I went to my room, locked the door, and all I could think about is, I am such a bad person, I deserve to be dead. And she started thinking about killing herself and how to do that. And the people are in that kind of suffering. You know, that's what we want to prevent. You know, she may not have gone on to kill herself, but just that agony and anguish and that self-hatred, what we want to do is to try to help block that. You know, and again, you know, by looking at the resources of Alzheimer's Association and more encouraging people to call. And then the last one is, do I wish my loved one would die? You know, which is such a powerful and difficult thing for people to say. And yet when they say it, and I just sit there and I say to them, I understand, you know. I get how hard this is for you. And they feel like somebody is empathizing with them rather than correcting them. Oh, you don't mean that. You know, well-intentioned family members and others often, you know, they just say things that don't help because the person doesn't feel connected. What she and many of these people that say this to me, I know they don't mean they're going to go in there and kill that person. Although we have to assess for murder, suicide. And that's the place that we have to sometimes tread is, well, I need to make sure I'm asking the right questions, you know, as Judy demonstrated when she was sharing that vignette. And so we want to be aware, too, I'm not going to go into these details, but we want to really be able to look at caregivers and realize when enough is enough. You know, the high cost of caring is often compassion fatigue. And that fatigue or exhaustion can really affect how the person thinks. And again, what can start, you know, germinating is depression and suicidal ideation because they're just too fatigued, too exhausted. And there's very little room to experience any joy when I am so exhausted. So we want to be aware of depression in caregivers, but also with people particularly have early stage dementia. And I know that we're getting better at that and better treating people with dementia that are also depressed. Even though that person with dementia may not be able to make that clear that they're feeling depressed, And I think we're getting a little bit better, but I think we need to talk about that more. And also grief, that I need to grieve for myself. I know that if I am ever diagnosed with dementia, Alzheimer's type, and I have this in a note to my son, and I just always want to say, can you imagine being my son and what the poor guy has to go through? I talk about death and dying and all these things all the time, and I have all these notes that are for him. And I say publicly, oh, Zach, I'm so sorry. But the idea is that let me grieve. You know, let me grieve. Help me grieve. Because there is a lot of sadness and disappointment. And again, assumptions that might not be fulfilled need to be grieved. And when people are discouraged, we need to really comfort them if they're unable to comfort themselves. So we want to be aware of depression. And also, as I implied earlier, loneliness can really be an extremely difficult situation for a caregiver and or the person that is dealing with symptoms of dementia themselves. And it's very difficult when the caregiver perceives themselves to be dealing with this situation alone. And that's what I think what Jake was doing, is that he was really in this, but had no, again, experience for it in terms of, oh yeah, I know what it was like when I was in this role professionally, or I was in this role with my sister. Oftentimes people are thrust into these roles and they don't know what to do, and then they slip into this feeling of isolation, loneliness. And it's very difficult when the person that we would share our troubles with, our intimate concerns about our life, is a person that is no longer available for us. And this is often referred to as ambiguous loss. Ambiguous loss is that the person is physically present, but psychologically unavailable. And we don't acknowledge that enough. It really, even as I'm standing here with you, I'm thinking of some people, it just breaks my heart that they have tried to tell their adult children or their own siblings about what's happening to them in relationship to their spouse. And when this one woman, she was so great, she said, my adult children are my children. They're my husband's children. I am my husband's best friend, partner, spouse. You know, we've been through ups and downs together. It's very different. And when my adult children say, oh, you know, don't talk about this. You talk about it too much. It's too hard for her. And she said, they're giving me the wrong advice. What's hard is being quiet. I need to talk about this. Ambiguous loss. My husband is still physically present, but psychologically absent. That's very, very tough on people. And it's a lonely place for them to be. And so we need to be able to help people reduce some of that stress. And that's what Judy was also saying, which is, let's see who else is available. How can other people help us? And so we want to be aware of that. We want to recognize warning signs again of stress. Helping people discover vocabulary without feeling like they're bad people. You know, this again, the way in which we look at caregiving is like you have to be, again, this miracle worker on no sleep, which I think is just an enormous responsibility that nobody can bear. So helping people find vocabulary, identifying sources of caregiving stress, et cetera, to let people talk about it, not only the caregiver, but also, as Judy was saying, in the early stage dementia support group, helping people there find the vocabulary that helps them really be able to express what's going on with them. It's just, again, so important. And, you know, again, just in terms of depression, it's very challenging to diagnose. You know, one of the things that Dr. Conwell, who is really a leading authority in terms of suicide and the elderly, what he says often is that when you look at these suicide stats and you do psychological autopsies on people 65 plus, what you find is that they have a diagnosable depression, but it was never diagnosed. And so we have people who are out there clinically depressed, but they're not treated. And it's no wonder that things turn dark, because we know that one of the criteria for clinical depression is recurrent thoughts of death and suicidal ideation. It's right there. You know, and we need to be able to help individuals see that, again, with older people, there's still this notion that if I'm depressed, you're really saying that I'm crazy. And we think we're it's 2015. Aren't we sophisticated enough to understand that this type of mental health issue can be remediated to some degree and for some people pretty well? But we still have older people who still insist that you're calling me crazy. And so I won't talk about that. And we need to really, again, pay more attention to depression. On some of the boards I'm on nationally, one of the things that the membership often says is we need to go back to the basics. We need to go back to making sure we understand depression. And whether it's the caregiver or the person with dementia, we need to make sure that we understand whether or not that person is also dealing with depression. And hopefully that will help. So we want to be aware, too, of functional capacity, you know, physical health. What Dr. Conwell and, again, and his colleagues talk about is the problems with IADLs, that if I am no longer able, again, we tie that into this notion of a value system that says, I have to do everything on my own. And if I ask for help, I'm going to be overwhelmed by shame, embarrassment. You're going to think less of me. And again, we've got to really figure out a way to say to people, it's okay to ask for help. It's okay to say in my support group, I'm feeling so bad that I have thoughts of suicide. You know, and then as Judy demonstrated, there's a way that we can handle that. You know, functional impairments play key roles in the desire for suicide. And particularly, one of the biggest ones has to do with driving the car. You know, if I walked around here today, if Judy and I walked around, we said, you can't get your car out of the parking lot. We need your keys and your driver's license because you are deemed unable to drive, not fit for driving, would you willingly take your keys out and say, here's my driver's license? What would you feel? What would a feeling be if we walked around and said, you have to give up that driver's license? What would you feel at that moment? What? I think you'd feel, well, some said suicidal. I think that's really true. I mean, that's how much we don't want to take the Muni in San Francisco. But the ideas would be really angry, you know? And we might say, no way, or yeah, go ahead and take it, but I still have a spare key and I'm going to go drive anyway. And we fail to recognize that that is a major loss, you know, because it has something to do with my ability to function and that has taken it has been taken away. We wait till there's a crisis rather than being able to say, we need to plan that now. What would you do? Now you're healthy today. What would you do in 5 or 10 years if you had some cognitive impairment? If you had a problem, I have my son's godmother is 74, and she finally had to give up this car, a 1966 Plymouth Valiant. Oh, God. And she said, this is the worst thing I've ever encountered in my life. Giving up that car, even though she knew she couldn't drive. What she often did was go out to the car and sit in it. And she said, if I wasn't getting so many parking tickets, I would have continued just to have it there. But that tells you how much that ability to function, even though she knew she couldn't drive the car anymore, but she wanted that idea, you know, of what it used to be, you know, and that is really powerful. Presence of perceived autonomy, even in the presence of functional impairment and social connectedness, may buffer against risks of suicide. So where somebody can feel independent, where somebody can feel autonomous, we want to encourage that, you know, rather than clamping down on them. People really need, whether they have symptoms of dementia or not, they really need to believe that I can make some decisions. And that ties into their value system, and that's very important for us to remember. So what are some of the reasons for suicidal behavior? Now, Dr. Thomas Joyner, is anybody familiar with Dr. Joyner? Any hands? No? Dr. Thomas Joyner, his dad died by suicide. And so he's made one huge part of his career is to really help us understand what would make someone go from I'm ideating suicide to I am going to complete the act of suicide. And his is called an interpersonal theory of suicide, interpersonal theory of suicide. And what he says is serious suicidal behavior requires the desire for death. Desire, you know. There has to be some intense energy, you know, that we can kind of sense with people who are really into that kind of mode of thinking. And the desire for death is composed of two psychological states, perceived burdensomeness and failed belongingness. And this is what I often hear in people that don't have cognitive impairment or memory loss, but feel that if they would, they are going to slip into this because they already say, I will be a burden to my family and I don't want that, you know? And I won't belong anymore because of these strict social rules that you have to be on top of it, you know? Rather than, do we ever get a break and say, maybe I don't have to be on top of it now, I'm 99 years old, for heaven's sake. You know, do I have to be 40 forever? And we need to be able to think about that. But that's what I was hearing when Judy was talking, even on the phone when we did that, is that he was feeling like, Jake was feeling like, I'm going to be a burden, you know, and I'm not going to belong anymore, you know. My wife's going to die. My role is husband, you know, my identity, you know, is the caregiver or whatever. And so I don't belong anymore because I don't know who I am. And I know those of you that have had a significant loss of a loved one knows that for a while you're very disoriented in your grief in terms of who am I? You know, it was my son or daughter died, and am I still a mother or father? You know, my spouse died, am I still a husband? How do we reconcile that? When these psychological states occur, the desire for death is produced. So when you hear someone say, and we hear it often, I know I hear it often, thank you. She's my best friend here in terms of keeping me in line. When people are saying, I'm a burden, or I don't belong, and we hear it, I know you hear it. How many of you hear that on some kind of a regular basis? What that person is doing is that they are really in this state of thinking about death. And in many ways, you know, many of us in this room have probably thought that, even without burdensomeness and not belonging, because we know at some point, you know, we're living with impermanence. You know, Irvin Yalom, in his book, Staring at the Sun, Overcoming the Terror of Death, says, we got to get it together existentially in terms of understanding that life is going to come to an end. We're living with impermanence. And so combined with the acquired ability for self-injury and a serious suicide attempt can follow. So what Dr. Joyner says, here's what we have to think about. We need to think about, and that's why I was so alert to Jake and having known somebody that has attempted suicide. Yeesh, the time. You know, if somebody has attempted suicide, even as a 17-year-old, and now they're 70, but if there was no meaningful intervention, what they have as an experience is, I know what it's like to get close to taking my own life, you know? And for many people in this room, you're probably saying to yourself, I've never even thought about suicide. That would never even occur to me. But to a lot of people, during troubled times, oftentimes, you know, during transitions as an adolescent to young adulthood, or, you know, having a divorce at 25 or 30 with two kids, et cetera, et cetera. I think about suicide, or might have attempted. A non-multiple attempter with three out of the following five symptoms: single suicide attempt, aborted suicide attempts, which is I thought about it and then I didn't carry it through. Self-injecting drug use, any kind of self-harm, which is cutters that might have in their youth been so unable to express emotion that they had to cut themselves. Frequent exposure to physical violence. And that's what, you know, Thomas Joyner would say about, we know that 22 returning vets per day have died by suicide. More people have died by suicide in the military than have died in armed conflict. But they've acquired the capacity for self-harm. That's what we want to make sure that we talk about with people is, you know, if they are saying that I feel like I'm a burden, I don't belong, and again, people with illnesses in our culture often will go silent, will go deep inside of themselves, and they don't express their needs. We have to be able to change. And so just be aware of the relationship between depression and suicide in older people. It's when you look at risk factors, what you see is depression at the top of the list in terms of older adults. And it frequently accompanies a chronic illness, particularly when the disease impairs function. So having a diagnosis of dementia fits right in here. And so physical health status is the most consistently reported risk factor for the onset of the persistence of depression in late life. And so we also want to be aware of older men and suicide. I wanted to make sure that we had a chance for some questions. And I know there are people here that have microphones. Is that true? Is there, where, can you tell me where you are? Oh, is there a microphone? See, I can't see. Well, I still can't see. So does anybody have a question for Judy or myself? We'd be happy to respond because we do have some time. Any questions, thoughts that you might have? Yes. Yeah, if somebody could, I just can't hear you. Oh, there's the microphone, okay.
Hi, my name is Paula Wolfson. I'm the manager of social work at Avenidas in Palo Alto. We were on the scene when a 92-year-old went into the university cafe. They hit the gas instead of the brakes and injured diners. So we partnered with the paramedics and the police, and we had a driver safety forum, and we reframed the conversation. So if you want to write anything down that's going to be important, write this. This is an ancient ritual that you can do. It's called a car mitzvah. C-A-R, and what you do is you honor the person for being a moral member of a community, an age, a coming-of-age ritual. They give up the car keys, and you turn it into some sort of legacy of celebration that they've decided to do this. So that's what we did. We had 88 seniors show up, and we had a 92-year-old retired physician give up his car keys. You have to think about these things and reframe them.
Yeah. Thank you.
Patrick over here.
Okay.
So I have a question, and it actually relates to this case that Judy raised and others, and that is
as a psychologist and having worked with people who were suicidal previously, I find it's a little different when people are talking in a theoretical future state. So instead of saying, today I have this intention or this plan, they're saying, if I get to the point where I'm dependent or if my wife dies, then I will be suicidal. And that was a challenge. And Judy and I talked a lot about this in terms of, well, what do you do with that when you're trying to make sure someone is safe? And so I'd love to hear your thoughts on how do you handle that clinically.
Yeah, one of the things that often comes up, and again, I know people in this room might have said that to themselves. And what suicidologists do with that information is say, I really thank you for telling me that, because why don't we monitor that together? And when you get to that point, what we want to make sure is that I'm there with you, you know, that we have a connection and we have an agreement that should you get to the point where you have a really poor vision or, you know, you cannot hear anymore, et cetera, et cetera. And what the literature says about people like that is because they've never been there, they don't know the terrain. So what they are is that they're projecting their fear forward. And so what we can do is we can talk to them about functional impairment, you know, what's happening. But when we get there, what the literature says, what is very interesting is that when people get to the spot where their fear is now present, what they've learned along the way is better coping. And what Dr. Conwell says is that the human spirit, though bruised and battered, is often very hard to stop. And what people will do if they were fairly healthy in life is that they've learned now some new coping. And part of that is, as Maury Schwartz, if you remember Maury Schwartz and his ALS, he said, what we don't do in this culture is that we don't grieve the little losses. And that's why I like what you said about the kar mitzvah. I like that. Oh, there you are. I like that. But I think we need to do that. I think we need to be able to get close to the bone in terms of what this is. It's fear, you know, and what can we do to extend whatever these issues are so that you can be as healthy as possible for as long as possible. But my experience has been, as long as we have an agreement that we're together and we get to that spot, what have we learned? What can we implement?
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. Am I projecting?
I can hear you.
Okay, good. I'm LaVon Hendricks, and this is also my 17th updates on dementia. Will also be my last because I'm retiring. But I wondered if you're aware of any different kind of conversations that may be taking place in those states where suicide is legal.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up. I knew somebody would, so thank you. One of the things I think California has to prepare for, so we know that's going to be on the ballot again at some point, that Right to Die initiative. And one of the states such as Vermont, Montana, certainly Oregon. And we've learned a lot from the state of Oregon because what we're seeing is that there's, at least in terms of the research that has been available, is that for those of us that might have thought there was a slippery slope, what we're seeing is that the criteria has been very effective in terms of making sure that people who have a treatable depression aren't slipping into the group of people that are going to die prematurely as a result of suicide. So I think things are right now, I think, pretty positive in terms of the states that have that option. And that I don't see abuse, at least in the literature. But what I'm always concerned about is I'd rather not have legislators make the decision about a topic as important as Right to Die. I would rather have everybody in this room involved in that procedure and process, because I think we have a much better take on it than they do. And my final thing is that I do think we have to look at other ways of dying in this culture, so it isn't just I die as a natural response to whatever that illness is, or I have to kill myself. Surely, to God, we can find other ways that aren't going to be a loss of somebody's dignity. I think we have a lot of really powerful, important, and thoughtful people, and I think we need to come up with some other options.
Well, just to piggyback on that, HPNA, the Hospice and Palliative Care Nurses Association in the San Francisco Bay Area, they are having a conference this Saturday at St. Luke's on the right to die legislation. So, and I think they still have room, and it's only $20, so if anybody wants to go, that it's there. The other thing I wanted to add was to ask you if you were if you had services in the East Bay, and I have one more thing to add after that. You want me to go ahead and add the third thing?
Well, let me, no, because I won't be able to hold those slots. let's go with the easy one. In terms of the East Bay, Friendship Line is available throughout the country in terms of the 800 number. So an Institute on Aging has divisions in Santa Clara, San Mateo, and Marin. But Friendship Line is all across the country.
Oh, okay. And so the third thing is regarding giving up the car keys. What I told my mom, who's got dementia, is that she didn't need to drive anymore because she was going to have a chauffeur. And so being a child of the Depression, she was like, oh, okay, that works.
That, so, absolutely. That's good. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Fumiko. I'm a senior case manager from Kimochi, San Francisco. So I have a client, Asian male. He attempted suicide 3 years ago, and when he was drowned, and his neuropathy got really bad. And so 2 months ago, he came to the family caregiver support group, and we talk about depression and a family, and he mentioned his attempt in front of many Asian people, I mean, mostly Japanese. And so I was very concerned. I visited him. He said he used a sleeping pill last time, but he said, unfortunately, I was found. And when he was in hospital, counselor, who has, I think, a background, Christian background, tried to talk him into not trying another attempt. However, he said, in Japanese culture, you know, like a samurai tried to commit suicide, and sometimes it was for honor. And so he said everybody treated him like a crazy person. And I asked him if he has any immediate plan. He said when he becomes incontinent, he will probably try again, but not right now. And he said, I'm not depressed. I'm happy. I'm achieved so much in my life, so I don't have anything else I need to do. And his partner passed away last year, so he doesn't have any responsibility. So I try to keep contact with him, but he was not happy how the counseling goes after the first attempt. And also, when he was a teenager, his brother commit suicide in Japan. So I wanna have.
Well, yeah, thank you so much. And I think what you bring up is, again, a really important aspect has to do with culture. And not only a person's personality, stressors, but also one's culture. And again, I think that the professional that worked with him after the first attempt might have been scared himself or herself, didn't know what to do. And I'm really sorry that happened to him, but I think we have to really be mindful of culture and how culture impacts the way in which one looks at one's health issues or a suicidal ideation or an attempt. I think he's given you a lot of information, and I think the fact that his brother died by suicide would fit right into what Dr. Joyner's talking about, which is even though he may not have had the attempt, that someone close to him did. Thank you. I know I'm getting the high sign. We have to end, and I just want to end with this very short statement, and it goes back to what I said in the beginning about what Judy did in terms of attention. And what Mark Brady talks about in his book, The Wisdom of Listening. And this is what I think we need to really sharpen our ability to really listen in a meaningful way. Caregivers access deep and direct insight into what's valuable, virtuous, and effective in terms of fostering human growth. What's valuable, virtuous, and effective is the gift of our attention. Our simple attention offered to another person is the most underused of human resources, one of the least costly, one of the most freely available, and without doubt, one of the most powerfully beneficial. What I urge us to do is listen more and talk less. Thank you. And thank you, Judy.